Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marta Di Filippo, and today I will talk about a model-based data integration pipeline to characterize the multi-level regulation of cell metabolism. This is the outline of my presentation. So after a brief introduction on the complex regulation of metabolism, I will present you the pipeline we developed and the results we obtained, finally closing with a few take-home messages. So, metabolism constitutes among all the cellular processes the closest level of investigation to cell phenotype. And characterizing metabolism and its regulation is of paramount importance in various fields like health, wellness, and biotransformations. And for that purpose, the first requirement is the knowledge of metabolic fluxes. But however, their direct determination, mainly due to technical difficulties, still lags behind other omics technologies like metabolomics and transcriptomics, which are increasingly being collected, but they don't allow for an accurate characterization of metabolic regulation unless opportunely integrated. And therefore, there is a need for integrating methodologies for disassembling the interdependence between different regulatory layers controlling metabolism. But let's clarify first of all why it's not trivial to link metabolite and gene expression variation with flux variation. So, imagine that we are comparing two cells A and B at steady state. And let's focus in this small toy network on this irreversible reaction V3 catalyzed by the enzyme E3. What may occur is that a significantly higher expression of enzyme E3 in cell A compared to cell B may be due to different scenarios. If together with the higher expression of enzyme E3 also the availability of substrate B is increased, then the flux of V3 also increases. And because both the enzyme activity and substrate availability are consistent, we talk about a consistent metabolic and transcription regulation. But it may occur, paradoxically, that a significantly higher activity of enzyme E3 in cell A compared to cell B through transcription regulation might associate with a lower flux through reaction V3 if the reaction substrate is dramatically lower in A than in B. And this is not impossible because a decrease in substrate availability might in turn depend on environmental regulation, resulting in a lower availability and so lower supply of nutrients. Or in alternative, it might also depend on different regulation of the reaction producing such metabolite, so resulting in an indirect transcription regulation. In this case, we can say that transcription metabolic regulation are inconsistent, and so who prevails? If the decrease in the substrate is dramatically lower than the increase in enzyme, we refer to a metabolic control. But it may happen that the enzyme activity is high, the substrate has not changed, but we have a higher supply of the nutrients that is constantly consumed by the reaction V3, and consequently, we may not observe an increase in substrate, but still the flux of this reaction will be up, and so will be consistent with the transcription regulation. Therefore, due to this different kind of fluxes regulation, it couldn't be enough to tell you which fluxes are different, since it's also fundamental to know how fluxes are controlled, so that if you want to interfere with a specific reaction, based on the type of regulation, it's possible to plan with targeted measures. Against this background, we propose the integrate pipeline that we develop for integrating transcriptomics and metabolomics data in order to identify the level of control of reactions in different biological samples, exploiting transcriptomics data, exometabolomics and intracellular metabolomics, together with the generic metabolic model that needs to include the GPR rules, which are logical expressions describing how gene products concur to catalyze the associated reactions. And the core process of this methodology that is here depicted consists of integrating the input dataset into the input metabolic model in order to obtain these three reaction-oriented derived datasets. The first one is the reaction activity score datasets that include for each reaction in the input model and for each sample a RAS score that tell us how active is a reaction in a given cell according to the associated GPR rule and to the expression of the genes involving its catalysis by taking the minimum expression value of genes encoding for subunit and the sum of expression values of genes encoding for isoforms. Then, the feasible flux distribution dataset includes a large number of flux distributions associated with a given cell line, obtained by uniformly sampling the feasible flux region of the metabolic model that has been previously tailored on that cell line by integrating RAS score derived from transcriptomics together with extracellular constraints. And finally, the reaction propensity score tells us the propensity of reaction according to the availability of dairy substrates. In particular, we assume the mass action law that states that the rate of a reaction is proportional to the rate constant and to the product of substrate concentration, each one raised to the power of its stoichiometric coefficients. So if you do this assumption when we compare two steady state I and J, we can say that the flux ratio of this reaction in steady state I over steady state J is equal to the ratio of the two mass action law formulations. And if you assume that the enzyme is the same in the two steady state, we can simplify this expression, and so we can just say that the ratio between the two fluxes is equal to the ratio between the two product of substrate concentrations. Therefore, if we know that the product substrate concentration in steady state I is higher than in steady state J, we can conclude that VI is higher than VJ. So integrate, intersecting these three derived datasets, can discriminate fluxes that are regulated at the metabolic and or transcriptional level. To show a proof of principle of our pipeline, we collected experimental data on four different breast cancer cell lines with an expected metabolic heterogeneity and a normal breast cell line, bearing in mind that the methodology is general, so it can be applied to any group of samples. Our work also included the reconstruction of the human central carbon metabolism and of the essential amino acid metabolism in a corno model that we call ENGRO2, that we use a scaffold for integrating these three types of experimental data collected from the investigating cell lines. We decided to integrate them in the form of relative constraints in order to better discriminate the metabolic differences between the cell lines. In particular, we integrate the constraints on nutrients availability, on the extracellular flux ratio, and on the reaction by using the RAS score derived from transcriptomics data. In particular, to integrate this score, given constraints C1 and C2 imposed on the model, we compute for each reaction and for each cell line the maximum achievable flux M. And after that, since we have cell relative models, we let the cell with the highest RAS to reach the maximum achievable flux M, and then we assign to the other cell a lower upper bound proportional to the relative RAS, computed as RAS of that cell over the maximum RAS among all the cells. After the detailed application of these constraints into the model, we compare different cell lines by sampling the solution spaces of the five cells, investigating with a clustering approach, as shown here on the left, how additional constraints influence cell line separation. And you can observe how we go from medium constraints to transcriptomics constraints, the flux distribution of each cell line starts to be well separated, achieving a more compact clustering when also the flux ratios are added. And the same situation is confirmed on the right by the increasing in the correlation coefficient between the computational and experimental growth yield, computed as a ratio between biomass flux or protein content over glucose uptake rate. So the idea is that the transcriptomics data alone can well separate flux distributions, but if you want a more accurate yield, you should probably also include the constraints on extracellular fluxes. Once the three reaction-oriented datasets are obtained, Integrate performs a statistical test to assess for each dataset and for each pair of the investigated cell lines whether the value of each reaction is significantly higher, lower, or if any significant difference is observed. Here in particular, we are looking at the cytosolic alkalinase, which converts citrate into isocitrate. And after the test, we will basically have black, red, and blue values for each reaction in each pairwise comparison, for the flux distribution, for the reaction propensity score, and for the reaction activity scores. And what we can do with these values is to look at a contingency table. So in all the pairwise comparisons of cell lines, we evaluate the qualitative concordance of variation sign between these two pairs of datasets by computing the Cohen's kappa coefficient that tells us how concordant two measures are. In this case, between the feasible flux distribution and the reaction propensity score, we obtain a kappa coefficient of 1, meaning that for this reaction and for all the 10 pairwise comparisons, we observe that data deriving from transcriptomics and exometabolomics produce the same results compared to data deriving from metabolomics. On the contrary, we obtain a negative kappa coefficient between the reaction propensity score and the RAS values, so meaning that in this case, the two measures are discordant. So evaluating the two computed score, we can conclude that this reaction is metabolically controlled. And of course, we did it for each reaction for which we have measures for all the involved substrates from metabolomics data, reporting in this plot all the transcriptional and or metabolic control reaction. And the same information is also here reported with the equation of the reaction and the obtained values of kappa scores. Interestingly, among the metabolic control reactions that are colored in pink, we have some cases like this one or this one, for which we haven't any GPR rule in the model, and so thanks to Ngar regulation, we can also predict fluxes for which we don't have transcription information. Many other analyses can be conceived and performed downstream of our analysis, and as an example, as reported here on the right, we investigated fluxes that better discriminated the investigated file cell line, and also in this case, the aconitase come up, proving to be discriminator of the investigated lines and suggesting so a need for further investigation. So in conclusion, we presented integrate pipeline to predict metabolic flux distribution and their underlying regulation by integrating transcriptomics and metabolomics data. The integration of transcriptomics data into constraint-based models support flux prediction by taking into account both direct and indirect regulation at transcription level, and the environmental constraints derived from exometabolomics data improve the prediction we obtained. The metabolomic data and the mass action law formulation provide indication on how metabolic regulation is expected to translate into differences in metabolic fluxes, and so if we integrate all this data, we can discern fluxes that vary consistently at the metabolic and transcriptional regulation level from fluxes whose variation is concordant with just the metabolic or the transcriptional regulation only. So I would like to thank all the people that collaborate with me in this project, and obviously you for the attention.